One of the unique elements about this book is that while we discuss most of the key concepts taught in many other management classes, we don't always follow the order of the presentation that might be used in many traditional textbooks. And this was done intentionally, because in the real world, management challenges don't always occur in a predictable manner. One day you might have an issue that relates to the overall big picture strategy of your business, while the next day it might relate to meeting a legal requirement, and on another it might deal with motivating an employee having a bad day. And we wanted to convey that uncertainty and lack of predictability in the book. And we discuss this theme of uncertainty in business in the book by making an analogy to chess. In both business and chess, you have to deal with elements you can't perfectly predict, your own uncertainty as well as that of your opponent. The ideal next move is often unclear. In chess and business, you can take old moves and put new twists on them. In both contexts, it's important to know your opponent and know yourself. The idea of knowing yourself as well as your enemy dates back at least to Sun Tzu's Art of War, a classic book on Chinese military strategy. Sun Tzu said, "If you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles. If you know yourself but not the enemy, for every victory you will also suffer a defeat. If you know neither the enemy nor yourself, you will succumb in every battle." So this idea of effectively knowing yourself, and by extension, knowing your organization, as well as the industry and greater competitive environment you operate in, is the theme of this chapter. A popular framework to help create self-awareness for organizations in light of environmental forces is called SWOT analysis. This approach is useful for providing a snapshot of your organization in light of competition. In this framework, strengths and weaknesses refer to areas internal to your organization. For example, you might have great customer service as a strength. On the other hand, many new businesses struggle with cash flow as a weakness until they have established customer loyalty over time. Opportunities and threats refer to areas external to your organization. These are elements that management can't control. This is an important point because often when we discuss opportunities, we refer to different strategic options the firm might take. But with SWOT analysis, opportunities refers to changes or trends in the general environment. For example, the high cost of gasoline creates opportunities for alternative energy providers. So, the concept of opportunity in this context is something more about the industry or economy and its current conditions or how it might be changing than the organization that's being analyzed. One of the appeals of SWOT analysis is that it provides specific implications for what a company should do depending on the degree to which they generally have strengths or weaknesses compared to an environment that is generally optimistic or threatening. But SWOT needs to be used cautiously because it's very subjective, and we mentioned the problems concerning decision biases in the previous chapter. So, overconfident individuals may think their company has a lot more strengths than others might perceive. Or, the way information is framed could be seen as an opportunity to some managers, but a threat to others. So, while SWOT analysis is a good technique to start a conversation, it's not a definitive tool for analyzing an organization. The idea of knowing yourself is important at the organizational level in SWOT analysis, but it's also an important idea for individual self-awareness. Understanding personality is important in management because behavior is a function of a person's personality as well as their environment. One area where this interplay has been studied considerably concerns a phenomenon known as the Pygmalion effect. In Greek mythology, Pygmalion was a sculptor who created a statue of a woman so beautiful that he fell in love with his creation. The basic idea of the Pygmalion effect is that personality can be shaped to match expectations, much like Pygmalion shaped the statue to become his perfect idea of a woman. This idea has important implications for managers because shaping behavior is a key management task. Sometimes managers shape behavior by working to create self-efficacy in individuals. The concept of self-efficacy refers to the belief a person has that they can perform a specific task successfully. One study published in the Journal of Applied Psychology really tried to test the limits of this idea by shaping someone's self-efficacy. In this case, the researchers were hoping to create a seasickness self-efficacy, where if you believed you wouldn't get seasick, you'd be less likely to throw up when the water started to get rough. This was a pretty unique application of this idea, because seasickness is physiological, and everyone is subject to seasickness to some extent when the waters really get rough. In the study, the researchers gave members of the Navy several tests. Then, they told some of the subjects that they were less prone to seasickness based on the results to try to build their self-efficacy. The other group was shown the normal military training videos that included videos of people puking once the waters start to get really rough. When the sailors went to sea for the first time, they found that the group where they worked to develop seasickness self-efficacy was actually less likely to vomit. So this idea of shaping behavior has serious implications for a host of different organizations and contexts. This chapter also discusses how individuals can know themselves by understanding differences in personality. One well-known personality concept categorizes individuals into type A or type B. Type A personalities tend to be competitive, often in a hurry, often irritable, and loud. Type B individuals are exactly the opposite, calmer, quieter, and more relaxed. A more complicated framework that has received a lot of research support examines the Big Five personality characteristics. They can be remembered fairly easily using the acronym OCEAN. The idea behind this framework is that these five basic dimensions can be used to categorize the most common elements in anyone's personality. Individuals might be high, medium, or low on any of these dimensions. Understanding these dimensions is important because individuals tend to be relatively set in their personality in many ways. And tendencies in these personalities have implications for how individuals might fit with certain jobs. For example, the dimension openness to experience focuses on the degree to which individuals enjoy unusual ideas, variety in their experiences, and are curious and adventurous. Individuals high in this dimension might enjoy jobs that require creativity, such as advertising jobs. Conscientious individuals are self-disciplined, dutiful, achievement-oriented, and act in planned ways. Jobs that require attention to detail, such as those in insurance and finance, might be a good fit for an individual high in conscientiousness. Individuals high in extroversion are outgoing, positive, like to seek stimulation, and enjoy being with others. Extroverted individuals might enjoy jobs that are people-oriented, such as sales or customer service. Individuals high in agreeableness are compassionate, cooperative, and enjoy harmony. Jobs that require empathy, such as teachers and social workers, can be a good fit for individuals high in agreeableness. Neuroticism is a personality dimension characterized by those who experience unpleasant emotions, such as anger, anxiety, or depression, easily. Jobs that require limited interaction that do not have a great deal of stress would be ideal for individuals high in this dimension. So, understanding the Big Five personality dimensions helps individuals know themselves and their behavioral tendencies. The remainder of this chapter focuses primarily on understanding the external environment. We note that effective strategic management is a process that requires constantly scanning the environment. Then, managers interpret which environmental changes require strategic actions, and those actions impact firm performance. When we discussed the balanced scorecard framework in the previous chapter, we noted that firms need to examine their performance on a number of dimensions to fully understand how they are performing given the complexity involved in understanding organizational performance. Managers must constantly scan their environment and monitor factors outside of their control, such as changes in the overall economy or important industry trends. This might lead to knowledge that can encourage different actions for the firm, which would then impact the firm's performance. In this chapter, we examine the sleepdog framework that looks at a number of different dimensions or trends in the environment that might change over time. The famous hockey player Wayne Gretzky said his key to success was that I skate to where the puck is gonna be, not where it has been. In a similar vein, wise managers look at where their environment is changing to understand how to best keep their firms competitive over time. So let's take a closer look at one of these factors as an example of the importance of examining trends. Sociocultural factors include trends in demographics such as population size, age, and ethnic mix. For example, since the population in the United States is growing and more families have dual incomes, there's less time to prepare meals at home. This would suggest that the restaurant industry, as well as market for easy-to-prepare frozen dinners, should grow. Another well-known examination of a trend involves hemline theory, which looks at the correlation between women's hemlines and overall performance of the economy. The theory suggests that women's hemlines rise as stock prices rise, so shorter skirts are more popular in stronger economies, whereas in poorer economies, longer hemlines are more common. So, this is just a couple of examples to show that if we monitor general trends, it might provide important information relevant to the strategies of specific firms. Examining trends such as those in the sleepdog framework gives us some general insights into the types of businesses that might be growing or declining, Another important aspect relevant to knowing your competition involves understanding the determinants of industry performance. This is valuable information because average industry performance consistently explains firm performance more than any other variable. Classical economics attempted to explain industry performance by comparing industries with one major player, such as monopolies, with industries with many undifferentiated players, such as in the case of perfect competition. An example of a monopoly would be a utility company with no competitors, and a classic example of perfect competition is often farm commodities that are unable to differentiate their products. In between these two extremes is an oligopoly where a few firms control most of the market. Classical economics used an industry's concentration to measure the degree to which an industry fell between monopoly and perfect competition. Industry concentration measures the extent to which a small number of companies controls a large proportion of the market. So, in monopolies, the only firm would make up 100% of the competition since there is only one player. In the soft drink industry, the top three companies still make up nearly 90% of the industry's sales. Conceptually, the higher the concentration ratio, the higher the industry performance should be. However, a problem occurs using this method because contrary to this logic, some oligopolies exist in poor-performing industries. For example, a large percentage of sales is made up by a relatively small number of companies in the auto and airline industries, but these industries have been low-performing in recent years. This contradiction frustrated Michael Porter, a business professor at Harvard. So in contrast to the idea of just using one measure, such as industry concentration, to try and predict industry performance, he identified five unique forces that together help provide a more complex picture of industry dynamics and better explain competition within an industry. High competition generally makes industry performance lower. Threat of new entrants examines the extent to which barriers to entry in the industry are high or low. It's much easier to open a restaurant, convenience store, dry cleaners, or donut shop than a major airline. So, the threat of new entrants in the airline industry is fairly low. Say this another way, entry barriers to the airline industry are fairly high. In contrast, there are low barriers to entry in the donut shop industry, and that's why you see one in most towns. If the threat of new entrants is low, that's bad for industry performance because you never know when a new competitor can arrive on the scene and compete with existing firms. In Porter's five forces, substitutes refers to products in other industries that can substitute for the products in your industry. So in other words, it does not refer to competitors in your industry, which is in and of itself one of the forces, but it refers to products that can potentially substitute for what your industry offers. Identifying substitutes in this manner is important because they have the potential to make the industry obsolete. For example, the typewriter industry has been obliterated by PCs, laptops, and tablets. The bargaining power of buyers also has the potential to impact industry performance. In the auto industry, dealerships buy directly from automakers. Because there are so many more dealerships than automaking companies, the bargaining power of buyers is limited. In general, industry performance is stronger when the bargaining power of buyers is low. The bargaining power of suppliers can often have a dramatic impact on industry performance. For example, because the price of oil is often high and a key cost in aircraft operation, it makes it difficult for airlines to enjoy high profits. So, when bargaining power of suppliers is high, industry performance is often low. The unique nature of rivalry among existing competitors also determines industry profitability. In some segments of the auto industry, strong brand loyalty is a unique aspect of rivalry. Many truck owners are extremely loyal to either Ford or Chevy and wouldn't dream of buying the other brand. You don't see this dynamic in the cereal industry, for example, where Post and Kellogg's Raisin brands are nearly identical down to the packaging. In fact, rivalry in the cereal industry has been so genteel that they have been accused of price-fixing at times. So, Porter's five forces can give us a more complex perspective on industry factors to help us better understand the performance of an industry. For example, the airline industry is expensive to enter, and key expensive supplies have a dramatic impact on their performance. Buyers have little power, but the threat of substitutes such as trains and cars is significant for trips to up to several hundred miles. And airlines have trouble differentiating themselves and are perceived by buyers as all being about the same by consumers. In contrast, the pharmaceutical industry is generally profitable. There are not many new startups because it's expensive to enter the industry, most of the supplies that make up the drugs are not expensive, and buyers have little power but desperately need many of the products they offer. In many cases, substitutes are not available. In regard to rivalry among competitors, competition is limited by patents. Porter's Five Forces doesn't offer a perfect understanding of performance because we can't say that a specific number of forces make the industry more or less likely to be profitable, but it does provide insights into industry performance not offered by traditional economics. One of the fun things we worked into this chapter is a scene where Atlas asks his professor about starting a business, and the professor gives him a somewhat snippy response by just telling him to simply hire a lawyer to set up the paperwork depending on the business form he plans to use with the business. A business form concerns the legal structure of how an organization is established and directly influences how the organization interacts with its owners, the government, and other key stakeholders. And sole proprietorships, a single entrepreneur is responsible for all aspects of the organization. In partnerships, both rewards and liabilities are shared. A corporation offers protection from risks, but pays a higher tax rate. So, each form has strengths and weaknesses. But the point of that scene is that the key strategic management aspects that we tend to focus on in business school largely relate to the steps needed to develop and execute an effective and unique strategy, not so much the steps needed to legally start a business. And coming up with that unique viable strategy is Atlas's big challenge moving forward. And that's what we will focus on in the coming chapters.